Many tasks in Node-RED can be done with the default core node set, and when they're not enough, there's often an external package of nodes that you can install to fill in the gaps. But some applications just require more. In this workshop, I'll talk a little bit about function nodes and what they can do, like access persistent variables, as well as the JavaScript object notation or JSON format that the flow message uses. And finally, I'll talk about some other nodes like link and exec. With all of this at your disposal, you'll be well equipped to build clean, powerful, and sophisticated Node-RED applications. Having the ability to write your own JavaScript inside a flow is incredibly powerful. Just about all the tools of JavaScript are available to you, so if you already know the language, you'll be right at home. Otherwise, there are a ton of resources and books on the language for you to learn. Since most other nodes are essentially pieces of JavaScript, you can use the function node to replicate their processes and even do multiple tasks at once from the one function node. Of course, you can also go beyond that and make full use of the JavaScript language to customize your processing on the fly. As well as the conditional statements, loops, functions, string and array manipulation tools that you can use in JavaScript, there are also some functions specific to Node-RED that are very useful. They're all in the documentation on nodered.org. To give you a quick outline, function nodes are able to send messages to multiple output ports, send out multiple messages on a single port, or send out messages while processing before completing the code block and exiting the node. There's also the ability to log messages and errors, show status info during runtime, and store data persistently between function calls or even between deploys. Context, flow, and global are the three different levels that you can use to set, access, and modify persistent variables, where the range of their access is referred to as that variable's scope. Let's head over to Node-RED and see how this works. Here, I have a function node that uses context.get and context.set to keep a rolling count of how many times I inject this function node. So if I click done and inject a few times, you can see the counter go up in the debug window. If I try to access this context.count from another function node here, where I context.get count from below, if I inject this, I get undefined, since it hasn't actually been defined in the scope of this function node, only within the one above it. To fix this, I can increase the scope of count by going into the function and changing context to flow. Now, the variable count will be available from anywhere within this flow. I'll click done and change the other node to use the same. Now, if I click done, deploy, I'll see the number is reset since it is now under a new scope, and every time I inject, the count goes up, but I can also request it from this node. Now I'll take it a step further and go over to this other flow and try to inject flow.count. Now when I try to do it from here, I still get undefined, and that's because it isn't defined within the scope of this flow, only the other. To fix this, I can level up the flow once more, go into count, and edit it to be global instead of flow. I'll hit done, change over to the other tab, increase this to get the global count. Now when I deploy and inject, I can get the count from any flow that I would like. So while these global variables are universally accessible, some applications may be better off using a link node to share data between flows. Link nodes not only share variables, but can also trigger different flows across your project in a sequenced, predictable way. Here, I'll bring in an inject node and have it throw in the timestamp. I'll go down to the function section and use a delay node to set this off 5 seconds after I actually inject the message. I can send this to a link output node. I'll call this link example so I can find it later. Now I'll bring in a link input node, wire it to a debug, and connect the link to example. Now you can see the link has found its pair, and when I deploy and inject, 5 seconds later, I will see the timestamp appear in the debug window. And there it is. If I grab these two nodes, cut them, and paste them on another flow, then when I deploy and inject on this flow, 5 seconds later, I can go back to this other tab, and when the time appears, I can see by the dashed line that it's coming from this debug node. When I select the link node, I can see it is connected to my other flow. While persistent variables can be accessed across flows, they will not move an inject or flow message, only allow you to access your stored values. To move a message across flows, or to start one flow from another, you should use link nodes. So far, the messages I've been moving around have been pretty simple though, mostly a message object containing a single property, payload. This makes up the majority of node-read objects, but sometimes a node will require input or give output that is a much more complex message object. To get an idea of what this can look like, I'll use this HTTP request node to get a Weather Underground API object. I have this debug node set to display the complete message object in the debug window so that I can see the full structure. So I'll activate that and inject the node to see the object. Now when I expand it, Node-RED is already telling me that payload itself is an object, not just a variable. So I can expand that out and see that it contains two more objects called response and forecast. Forecast itself is a pretty complex object with text forecast and simple forecast objects. Simple forecast itself expands into an array called forecast day that holds 4 days worth of forecast data. Each of these objects contains a lot of data about that forecast. Here, I can expand high and low to see Fahrenheit and Celsius for both. If I wanted to find the path to this exact object, I can use this button on the left from the debug pane to copy the path to my clipboard. Now, if I go down to the function section and drag in a function node, wire that in between the message and the HTTP request, I can paste that path directly into my function node. Now I'll find out how to reference JSON objects. First, I use message dot to reference the payload, and then dot forecast to get that object, then dot simple forecast, and dot forecast day. Forecast day then requires square brackets to reference the first item in the list at index 0. Once I have that, I can reference high and Fahrenheit using the dot operator from there. If I were to return a new object using this as the message payload, hit done, deploy, and inject on this message, I can see that 76 degrees has come through. If I wanted to change this to get the low centigrade, for example, all I have to do is change those fields. Now when I hit done and deploy and inject, I can see the number 15 appear from the payload. That's how easy it is to reference different fields of JSON objects. Now, this weather object is very specifically organized and will be consistent with all calls from Weather Underground, but different APIs have different standards with what they output and even what they may take as input. Take, for example, the email node. You might remember this from the email alerts video. I'll go and click on one now so that we can look at what it says in the info tab. Here it says that you can set the email body using message.payload, the subject using message.topic, and recipients using to, cc, and bcc. You can either apply these using the email node's static settings, or you can hand them in every time you call the node using dynamic message objects. By using message properties instead of node settings to supply information, you're able to use the node dynamically as opposed to being restricted by your static settings. Another powerful node is the exec node, which allows you to run a command line instruction from within Node-RED. Be aware that this node is very powerful, and if you enter the wrong thing, it's possible that you could damage your system. Do not execute anything before you understand what it does. Here, I have an inject node setting off an exec node to read my Groovebox's CPU load using the top command. If I activate the debug node and inject on this flow, I can see that my CPU load of 1.5% appears in the debug tab. Now that it's in Node-RED, I could do anything with it, like plot it in Groove, log it to a database, or anything else I would like. The possibilities are only limited by what you want to do with your application. With these nodes and some understanding of JSON objects and JavaScript at your disposal, you'll be able to use Node-RED to easily create powerful applications that meet your need. You'll be able to do this no matter how straightforward or advanced your problem is. Thanks for watching.